Tonight, the state of Donald Trump. Does he have any sway left among Republicans on Capitol Hill? Was his Afghanistan surge just a distraction from other issues pressing he and his administration? And why is he campaigning in Arizona this evening? And what will he do while he's there? Is his White House suffering from a case of the summertime blues? Then the debate over removing Confederate monuments. We're going to share opinions from both sides, and then our panelists will weigh in to give their takes. And also, what should you do if you're invited to meet the president? How about a president you don't like or support? Well, it's not a hypothetical question to a lot of folks, especially in the sports and entertainment world. Boycotts have happened before, and with Trump in the White House, they're now happening a whole lot. Evening, everyone, and welcome to RFL. I'm Richard French. Well, August, usually, I stress that word, usually a slow month when it comes to politics. Congress takes most of the month off. Presidents take vacations, some longer than others. And the minds of many voters, they're on the beach, not on the ballot box. But that has not been the case this August, and certainly not for this president. Last night, President Trump took ownership of the war in Afghanistan, kind of, sort of, addressing the nation to announce a troop surge. More on that coming up later in the program. Now, Trump's critics wondered if perhaps the president was trying to shift attention away from last week's rally by neo-Nazis and white supremacists in Charlottesville, and the president's defense of them, saying that there were bad people on both sides and some very good people marching with the Nazis. And of course, we've also seen the White House game of Survivor just continue. That with top advisor Steve Bannon, the latest one voted off the island and has returned to Breitbart, where he has pledged to ramp up attacks on the White House and many of his former colleagues. All this as polls show Americans were unhappy with the president's response to Charlottesville by overwhelming numbers. And late this afternoon, we hear this. Times reporting now on the widening chasm between the president and Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell. In a remarkable quote, the Times says McConnell, whose wife is in Trump's own administration as his transportation secretary, saying, Mr. McConnell has privately expressed uncertainty that Mr. Trump will be able to salvage his administration after a series of summer crises. And for more, let's bring in our friend Rick Klein, political director for ABC News. Rick, as always, never dull on the Hill. What are you expecting tonight in Arizona? Because it could go in a whole bunch of different ways. He could attack two Republican incumbent senators from that state. He could talk about pardoning Joe Arpaio. He could go off message on Afghanistan. I know it's a loaded question, but do you have any sense where he's going to use his time at this political rally?
This is a political tinderbox. I 100% agree. It could go in a lot of different directions. And I think you look at that volatile mix of local political issues between Jeff Flake and John McCain and Joe Arpaio and the mayor saying he doesn't want Trump to come, the national issues with Charlottesville last week and Afghanistan last night, and of course the typical atmosphere around a Trump rally in a border state with some swing elements to it. And I think this is the potential to be quite an evening. And I think the president himself is the guy that sets the tone. I mean, he just last night talked about finding a different tone and a different way of communicating with neighbors and owing that to the troops. Does he deliver on that promise? That's the tone that he gets to set tonight.
We mentioned a couple Republicans who have been critical of him, both Senators McCain and Flake. And I want to read a quote from a reporter on the Hill I know you know, Mike Allen. He said this for Axios, and I'm curious if you agree with his take. He said, GOP lawmakers know his, meaning the president's, bark is way worse than his bite, and they no longer fear his tweet threats or bluster. They not only don't like him or respect him, they don't fear him, which is power sapping. Turns out the bully can't throw a punch. And to that end, do you sense on the Hill right now, given what happened with the failure to repeal Obamacare, et cetera, Republicans are staying away right now, or they still view him as their last best hope?
I think it really depends on the state. There are some places where there is a race to out-Trump Trump. Look in Alabama. There's a Senate primary playing out right now where both candidates are trying to be as close to President Trump as possible. And that's going to play out in a whole bunch of Republican primaries through next year. That said, there are other places where members of Congress are saying, look, I don't really trust the president. I don't believe deeply in his mission, and I don't have to worry about him either. So they're beginning to declare independence. People like Jeff Flake and John McCain in that category. But I think it's too early to say that they don't fear his bite. I think the potential to move armies and to move supporters on social media, that's real. And I think there are, I've talked to Republicans who continue to say, look, I have to be careful about how I cast this exactly, because you don't want to unleash forces that you can't predict the outcome of. And that's what it means when President Trump tweets at you. So we're starting to see a slide, and I don't think he has nearly the power that he had even 6 months ago. But I don't think they're totally done with paying attention to this president by any stretch.
Well, are they supportive of what he said about Afghanistan? Because clearly candidate Trump said something 180 degrees from what we heard from President Trump last night. To be fair, he referenced that he had a change of heart, but nonetheless, that's not what he ran on.
No, he flip-flopped, there's no question. But one thing the Republicans are realizing is he flip-flopped more to the mainstream Republican position. This sounded like a George W. Bush speech, much more than a Donald J. Trump speech. That brings a comfort level. That said, there's an element of the base, and you saw Rand Paul say this was a mistake, and you also saw Steve Bannon's Breitbart out there with some screaming headlines criticizing this president. They are going to hold him to account for what he said. And he was brought to office by people that felt differently about his foreign policy based on his own words. They're going to remind him of that. He has an ability to control his base, but of course that has limits.
But what about the portion where he said he didn't want Washington micromanaging it? I mean, there's a role that Congress plays here. Do they, A, want to play a role in this, or do they want to leave it on the president's plate, or B, do they say time out? You know, this isn't in a vacuum, Mr. President.
They're not going to stand out of the president's way. I think, though, you'll have the hawkish Republican establishment wing that's willing to give the president essentially what he wants and what he's calling for, deferring to the generals. But no, I don't think this is going to end Washington micromanaging, and I wouldn't even think it will end Trump's micromanaging when it comes to it. Keep in mind, it was so vague in terms of the details of this new strategy, it's impossible to judge whether it's going to work or not. I don't know how, what metrics you could develop to suggest that, yes, it is working or no, it's not working. I think it's going to be a pretty fuzzy proposition for a while.
Last thing, Rick, tax reform. We hear that there's some support for this, but I thought a lot of that was predicated on savings from health care reform. Where are Republicans on this if you're going to be racking up deficits and they want to be the pay-go party?
Well, I think they've changed their ideology to fit the times. It would have been easier with health care, both for political reasons as well as fiscal ones. But there is momentum to get this done. And I think you're on an important point. There were many deficit hawks under the previous administration who suddenly are saying, you know what, I think we can allow the deficits to increase because there's going to be such amazing growth. It seems more like a Trumpian remaking of Republican conservative ideology than anything else.
Rick, great job as always. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Richard.
All right, coming up next, we bring in the panel, President Trump taking ownership of the Afghanistan war to a point, addressing the nation last night and announcing another troop surge. But the question is, what is our goal there? Will it work? And whose decision was this, the president's or the military? We have a bunch of questions. We're going to go searching for answers straight ahead.